Hello and welcome to the Gameshelf. I'm J-Mac and I don't really have a co-host this month. Gee, what with Matt being eaten by a ghoul and all, I really can't.
What the?
Hi.
Matt, I thought you were eaten by a ghoul twice.
Well, you know, these things are rarely permanent. I went on sabbatical to the Great Underground Empire to work on my podcast. Did you get my email?
I guess so, but I thought you were just referring to, like, your basement studio or something.
Well, I was, but then I found this leaflet.
Oh.
And,
okay. So what brings you back to the surface world?
Well, truthfully, the acoustics, just terrible.
So I see you brought some souvenirs with you there?
Yes, I have with me some tasty food.
Okay, that looks like donkeys to me.
These things aren't mutually exclusive.
I guess.
Hey, check it out.
What's this?
It's a real Zorkman.
It says Puzzle Pirates on it.
Dude, do I have to explain how the electronic game industry works to you?
I suppose not. Do you want this back?
Whatever.
Okay. Well, as it happens, the games that we taped most recently, even though you were eaten by grues and everything, and sorry about that, I'm glad you're feeling better. Actually, I think you're familiar with them anyways, so luckily I think we can talk about them.
All right.
Yeah. And the first game that we're going to talk about is one that's been very popular in the board game community for the last several years. It's called Carcassonne. It was designed by Klaus-Jürgen Wrede. I'm hoping I pronounced that correctly. Was originally published in Germany by Hans im Glück in 2000. Is published in the United States by Rio Grande Games and is actually published by a lot of companies all over the world in different companies, different countries, because it's actually a very popular game. In the last 5 years, in fact, Herr Wrede has come out with all sorts of different expansion sets and variants of the game. The one that we're going to talk about this month, however, is the basic game that comes in this distinct blue box. It just says Carcassonne. It doesn't say Carcassonne Inns and Cathedrals or Carcassonne Princess and Dragon or Carcassonne Hunters and Gatherers or any of the other side games. This is the plain vanilla box set. So the core mechanic of this game is that players take turns drawing tiles from a common stock or a boneyard, to use the dominoes turn. Each tile has features that look like features from sort of a medieval landscape on it, and these include roads, fields, pieces of a castle, or monasteries. As the game continues, the players basically build a map of a medieval landscape on the table. The placement rule is very simple. When you place a tile, it has to be next to a tile that's already there, and any edge that touches an existing tile has to continue a feature that is started by the other edge. So for example, if you're placing a tile that has a road on it, a road that's leading off the edge of the tile, you can connect it to another tile already on the table that has a road leading off, and you end up with extending the length of that road by one tile. That works the same for all the other features as well. What makes this game a little more sophisticated than simply dominoes with a map, however, is the way that the scoring actually works. So all the players have an army of little colored tokens that they can place on the map every time they play a tile. They have the option to do this, and players only have so many of these. By placing a token, you basically claim a feature on the tile that you just laid. And what you're trying to do once you do that is have that feature, whether it be a road or a field or the other types, to get as big as you can, and then you get to claim the token back and score points for it. The way a turn works is a player draws a tile, then they show it to all the other players, and discussion happens about where the best place to put that is. Of course, the final decision is up to the player.
Well, if you play it there, you have these two open things. You could take the field.
And that's an open corner, so it's got,
yeah,
it's got growth potential.
Could, theoretically.
Or you could finish them both and immediately score two cities as a farmer.
Hmm, but then I'd immediately have to, but that's a, the other side of that field.
Oh, but he's already got two in there.
He's already got two in there, effectively.
Yeah. All right.
To find a place that's likely to be entirely separate and form there.
Yeah. Well, that would be
way
there.
Out on
Jordan's
there. Road, yeah. For instance. Yeah.
Well, or yeah, down here might work.
Yeah. Sorry, I don't should be thinking about this that hard.
It's fine.
Let me try this. It's an experiment.
Interesting.
What I really need now.
The game being played here by our friends Gavin, Zarf, Julia, and Denis, all of them are actually old hands at this game who've been playing it for years, so there is quite a lot of sneakiness and fighting going on here and a lot of clever plays. So let's watch an example of each of the different terrain types, since the ways they score are all different. Roads are the simplest example. To score a road, you simply need to have the road end on both sides. Once that happens, you get to take your token back, put it back into your precious limited stock, and you score 1 point for every tile that road takes up.
I need to get guys back.
Finish my road.
So that's 4 points.
4 points. And I will place another road back.
Castles are the next good example, and they're also probably, while the game is going on, where most of the sneakiness occurs. Every tile involved in a castle that you get to score points for scores 2 points for you, and some of the tiles with a little shield icon on them score 4 points. We can see here that Gavin was actually being very sneaky and managed to sneak into a castle that Zarf started early in the game, so let's see how that turned out.
There we go.
That'll
matter later when we're low on people.
I would finish your city, yes. But do I want to do that? Probably not.
Of course you do.
You get.
Do you try and get into the city?
I could try to get into the city.
Just finish the racetrack to do that, though.
I could get a 2-point road someplace.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm getting into the city. Yeah, all right, sure, fine. Let's finish your road and try to sneak into your city sideways.
Okay, so we get 4 points.
Right. Right. Let's finish this.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, double to 16. Did I get that right?
Yeah, it looks right to me.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, yes, double to 16.
Okay, so 25 total for your yellow.
And black.
I am at 12 and 16, is 28.
I will get
my guy back, you get your guy back.
I got my guy back. No, I'm not doing the farm.
Okay.
Monasteries are a favorite among Carcassonne players because it's guaranteed no matter what your opponents do, you're going to get points out of that. That is because a monastery is only one tile in size. It's a little cloister. It only has room for one monk, apparently, and he sits there making cheese or whatever the Carcassonne monks do.
Oh, look, it's one of these things.
Oh, look, but not that one.
That looks like a particularly useful spot to put it.
You bastard. I mean, congratulations.
You're guaranteed to get between 1 and 9 points for a monastery, so it's a nice, relaxing place to build. The last feature of Carcassonne, and the most subtle one, and also the most confusing to new players, are fields, or farms. The way fields work is that they're a little strange. When you place a token in it, it's not scored during the game, and in fact, it's a long-term investment. Once you place a token in a field, you basically kiss it goodbye for the whole game. It stays there. Fields are not scored until the end of the game because nobody knows how many points a field is actually worth until the game is actually over. The game ends, by the way, when all the tiles from the bag or the box top have been laid out. At the end of the game, there's basically a reckoning period where each farm that actually has somebody's tokens in it, the point value of that is based upon the amount of completed cities that farm touches. In the game played here, there was basically two large fields that were being built. There was great competition, which we're going to watch here, between Gavin and Julia as they tried to sneak into each other's fields over and over again. However, it ended up that Zarf won the whole game because nobody contested the field that he was able to claim, and this gave him enough points to clean up. So let's see how the game ended.
Yes, it really does.
So I'll go from 8 to 28, which is probably really good for me.
I think so. Yes. Just leave them. And yellow and green alone gets that one.
Okay.
So that's 4 points for green?
Because green feeds it three times, and yellow feeds it twice.
Right.
Okay.
And then these three are shared for 12 points for both yellow and green.
Okay, so
green goes to 17.
17, and you go to
that's
yellow.
Yellow.
Yellow. Goes to 9 and 12 is
21.
21.
Ouch.
Oh, so close. And these guys are not connected to any
city. Yes, they feed.
And the monastery made the difference for you.
Yes. Yeah, cool. Very close.
Okay.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yep. All right.
And that is Carcassonne.
It is Carcassonne.
I have a confession to make, in fact, which is that on the whole, I'm not that big a fan of the game.
Really?
Yeah, it's. You should feel free to disagree with me on this, but I feel like I should like the game. It has a lot of simple rules. The mechanics allow for a lot of different things going on, strategy, a lot of things to think about while you're playing. And at the end of the day, though, the game just doesn't grab me. I'm open to the possibility that really the problem is that I'm just not very good at the game. Seriously. I may just not be good at the game and therefore not all that interested in playing it, but it's less appealing for me than it seems to be for a lot of the people we play games
with. Everyone else on Earth.
Everyone else on Earth.
Well, that's fine. Some of us are mutants, I suppose. You can actually play this game in a very competitive way so that, you know, you end up screwing over your opponents and you, like, can trap a monk in the monastery by arranging the tiles in such a way that the person will never be able to lay the ninth one down, and therefore that monk is stuck there forever. But even while you're doing that, the person you're playing with says, yes, actually, that's your best move, and darn, I should have seen that, you know, go ahead. There's sort of a strange psychology where maybe that person isn't going to point that out, but a third player who isn't directly involved in this conflict can point it out. Mm-hmm. And it isn't really, I mean, this isn't like a bluffing game or anything like that. It's not like you're playing diplomacy.
Right.
But I really like that aspect about how the group discussion dynamic can work into it.
The fact that you have a limited number of the tokens to put out may actually be part of the reason I don't like it. It has to be there as a game mechanic thing.
Well, it doesn't have to be there. I mean, it would be
a different game if you could just start dropping little people everywhere. This may be a me not being very good at the game thing, that I never have any confidence when I'm playing the game of when I can afford to put a person down and when, you know, if I play someone and it looks like it's a good move and then the person ends up being stranded on the board for the rest of the game and, you know, now I'm down a person for...
I still find it a great game that, you know, if you have a group of people over and people want to play a game, you can bust this one out and...
Right.
You know, it's a good time.
And it's not like I'm so hostile to the game that I refuse to play it or anything like that. It's just I'm less enthusiastic about it than a lot of the game players that I know.
Fair enough.
The second game we're covering today is the Very Clever Pipe Game, a hip pocket game by Cheap Ass Games. It's a very simple game. You have a bunch of cards in your hand, and on your turn, you play one of the cards from your hand, and then you draw a new card. So your goal when you're playing the game is to build a long, closed pipe of your color. You're either playing as, in the basic rules, you're either playing as the white pipes or the black pipes. And your goal is to create a pipe, which is either terminated at both ends or turns into a loop or otherwise is entirely closed. Let's watch Mary and Ruth start a game of the Very Clever Pipe Game.
Okay, I'm down to 5, so whenever you're ready.
All right. Start with that.
Ow! Okay, well, that's got a lot of openings.
I must have done something right. If you get that response.
That's got a lot of openings, so I have to hurry to close them there before you get other ideas.
So one of the strategies to playing the game is, well, first of all, you want to be completing your own pipes, but second of all, you want to be trying to sabotage your opponent's pipes by making theirs harder to close. The pipes, some of the cards have forks on the pipes, so if you play that down in your opponent, then they now have two places they have to close off instead of only one. This can be a risky maneuver because if your opponent succeeds in closing everything off, then they have a much bigger network and get to collect all the cards and score more points.
Two ends, no waiting.
Nice. Okay, time to thwart you. You're too close. Of course, on the other hand, I am giving you a lot of points here.
Well, if I ever close it, you're just going to keep grabbing those away from me.
Another more crafty way to close pipes is to create pillars. The cards are one by two. So if you lay the cards out in a way that you create a one by one hole in the board, that hole is impossible to fill. That hole automatically becomes a pillar and closes all the pipes that enter it.
I could pillarize that, perhaps. That closes, right?
Yes. And this one as well. Wait, no. I'm sorry, look at it again.
It was just,
yeah, you're
it was
right.
The end of the
it
pillar,
the
so it doesn't make my life any easier, but I don't have anything
points.
Useful
yeah,
in here.
At the end of the game, one player often has a large pipe complex, which they're trying to close, and the other player is often trying to block them. Let's see the end of Ruth and Mary's game.
So we'll do that. I don't think that closes anything for you either, but it looks nice.
Oh, it's cool though.
Yeah.
This. Yeah, wait, that could, no, it goes
no,
off.
No, it doesn't, yeah, because you were good about that. So, okay.
10.
16, but that was a fabulous first game.
You can also play the game with four players, in which case players are scoring on both the pipes and the fields. So two players will be scoring on the pipes and two players will be scoring on the fields. When you're playing with the fields, the game has the same basic placement rules, so you're still placing the cards so that the pipes have to match in the same color, even though you're scoring on the layout of the fields. This gets tricky because the placement becomes one mechanic and scoring becomes a different one. Sort of, they're sort of at right angles to each other in your brain.
I see what you mean about the backgrounds being hard to do now, because I find myself connecting the pipes, even though I don't really want to.
Well, they have to.
They have to match.
Oh, I have to, yeah.
Yeah, it has to be a valid pipe play.
Well, I'm going to put that there then.
Hey, that makes my life more interesting.
Well, that doesn't make everyone's life a little less interesting.
I thought you were going to pick it up, yeah.
So, black closes and comes around to the pillar. I get all of these cards.
Yes, we'll mark that one.
Oh my goodness.
Wow, well played.
Okay, then you need to draw a card as well.
I sure do. Thank you.
We'll need a
Someone's played this game before, and it isn't me.
I'm actually very good at this game.
So the fields and the pipes have inherently different scoring opportunities. The fields tend to score more often, but score with fewer cards. One card scoring with fields isn't uncommon. You'll place a card such that the pipes match up correctly, and you'll immediately enclose a field of your own color and just take that card back. Let's take a look at an example of that.
Well, I'm gonna do that.
Hey.
Okay.
And steal that.
Steal that one, okay, because you're light backgrounds. Mm-hmm. I'm working so hard.
So in the four-player game, there's more to think about. So the gameplay tends to be a little bit slower, but since you have more players, that means you have fewer turns for each player because the size of the deck is the same. So the game still goes pretty quickly. So let's watch the end of this game.
That helps me.
Last time we played it, and fails to help me.
Yep.
Actually, it doesn't hurt me, really.
this will probably be the last points I get this game, but it's something.
Don't start playing over there, we'll shoot you.
Point.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
And this.
And that one.
This.
Nice lift. Not let Denis be pipes, that was the problem.
Yeah, unfortunately it doesn't help me at all. I was hoping it would. Yeah. I don't think there's a...
Yeah, whatever. I'll put this there, and which, no way that would give someone
that a gives
point.
Me a point!
Sorry.
You could have not said anything, just, oh, thank you.
He would have figured.
Yeah.
I might have. I'll just do that.
Yeah. And that's it?
And that's it.
Count them up.
Ten.
12.
13.
Wow.
I am. Do you want some of mine?
Then I win.
Yeah. Oh no! I take it all back. So I'm under the impression that you actually like this game a little better than Carcassonne.
Yeah, I'm definitely more enthusiastic about the very clever pipe game. Again, really simple rules, but the strategic elements are more complex. You know, especially if you're playing with the fields, but also. Well, no, it's...
I wouldn't really say
I say that completely wrong. No, the rules are simple.
Yeah, but, the whole game's pretty simple, actually.
But there is complexity to the strategy of the game, which makes it worth playing.
Emergent properties, if you will.
Is what I meant. It's certainly a simpler game all around than Carcassonne.
Yeah, there's no markers, there's no claiming of territories for oneself. Opposed to the more open-ended variety of Carcassonne, where every territory can potentially belong to any player, and so long as they have the wherewithal to actually put their tokens on it.
I haven't actually played enough of the four-player game to have a sense of whether or not the balance really works or not. It's certainly fun playing four players.
Sure.
It's just sort of an open question I have.
In the game that we played, it's like, I think everyone thought that Denis was going to win and he was playing pipes, and then I just won at the end, and I'm not sure if that was just me being lucky and everyone was ignoring me, or I have no idea. But I was fields in that game, and I was making a lot of little scores, and Denis was doing these huge roomph things where he would just collect half the table. I think that's why everyone thought he was going to win, and it ended up being me, unless I miscounted. Right. But I never do that.
Yeah, it's another thing too. If you're just playing the pipes game, that you do have the question of strategy of, do you go for short pipes or do you go for trying to build a longer network and score the whole big network in one shot? And
I think scoring more often would be the thing you'd want to do, because
you have to mix it up a bit. It seems like if you can get a couple of big scores, you're set.
Yeah,
but it's hard to do.
But every time you collect cards, that's also cards away from your opponent's network, especially if you can score and also mess up what your opponent's trying to do.
Right.
That's something I do like about this game, is that you can score points and also at the same time hurt your opponent, not just by earning points, but by messing up their scoring opportunities.
Lots of opportunity for evil, I guess.
Yes. That's great. I'll actually use this opportunity to segue over to a digital game I want to talk about for just a couple minutes. There's not that much to say. But there was a game that was actually commercially available in the 1980s and known by a couple of different names. I think nowadays most people remember it as Pipe Dream. It was also sold, I think, under Pipe Mania and Pipe Crazy Monkeys, something like that. It was published by LucasArts mostly. But of course, it's such a simple game concept that you can now mostly find it as a Java applet. And if you go to our website and look at the show notes for today's episode, I have a bunch of links to a bunch of different versions to this game. You can follow one of those for your platform or play the web one. I bring it up because it too is a tile placement game. The premise of the game is simply that you are laying down tiles with little pipe icons on them that are all, you know, they're either straight pieces or they're elbows or they're cross pieces. And you simply click on squares of a grid and you're trying to build as long as a pipe as you can, starting from an initial spot that the computer picks for you. And the main gimmick is that the piece you can lay down is kind of like Carcassonne, given to you randomly. You can see what the next four pieces are, but the one that you place down is only the one at the end of that list. What you're trying to do is make as long a pipe as you can until the timer runs out. The fact that it is an electronic game means it can keep a timer for you. And in most of the versions, there's a point at which water or a liquid starts to flow through the pipe even as you're laying pieces down. And the round ends as soon as the liquid finally reaches a point where it comes pouring out the end, because you've either been too slow laying pipes down, or it reaches the end of the grid, or it touches another pipe and you haven't bent it the right way or whatever. The game's split up into levels. Each level you have a minimum number of squares that the liquid has to flow. If you fail to meet it, the game ends. If you succeed in meeting it, you score points and you go on to the next level that's harder. That's pretty much it. The different variations of the game, like add in special powers, like tiles that have power-ups of some kind, or the ability to like put bombs on the map and blow up tiles that you didn't want so you can change them. But it's all the same concept, and it's a very simple game. You know, there's not a lot of content to it. This was the sort of thing you could buy in a store 15 or 20 years ago, and people would actually pay $30 or $40 for this. Nowadays, like I said, you can find it around the internet, and we'll provide some links for you. It's a fun, simple, addictive game that you can fill a few minutes with, kind of in the same psychology as Minesweeper, except different. More plumbing-like. Yeah. That's all for this episode of The Game Shelf. As always, you can check us out on the web, gameshelf.jmac.org. You can find more information about the games that we talked about. You can find links to the different versions of Pipe Dream. You can find links to the board games we were talking about and how you can obtain those and other goodies like that. You can also find information about how to watch the show as a podcast, assuming that's not how you're watching it right now. I mean, the other way you can do that, of course, is to fire up iTunes on your computer, search for Game Shelf, and hit the subscribe button once you see the Game Shelf appear on that window. You can subscribe to the show for free that way and download new episodes as we happen to put them up. Speaking of podcasts, I understand you have a new show as well that you're doing.
So one of the things I've been working on while I've not been around for the past couple of shows is this new podcast that I'm working on, strictly audio. It's titled Some Things Matt Likes Aren't Very Good. I'm reviewing CDs. And again, you can subscribe to it through iTunes, or you can go to my website, thingsmattlikes.com, and download individual episodes from there.
Nice plug. I love RSS, don't you?
I'm a big fan.
Thank you, Dave Weiner. Okay, well, let's say bye-bye. Bye. See you next month. Dave Weiner.
I know.
Yeah.